is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Spoil Me, covering Deadwood, Season 1, Episode 2, Deep Water. In this episode, so this doctor is really fucking smart. Knows, I don't even want to say knows shit. He thinks things through in a way that I can only hope to someday achieve. And I respect the shit out of him. And this episode was so good. And I finished it and wanted immediately to move on to the next one. So Patrick, good call, man. Good call. Welcome to Spoil Me. Welcome to the show, everybody. I am Natasha. Again, shout out to Patrick for commissioning this episode. Thank you very much, sir. This show is really good. It's the kind of show that even though I just watched an episode, I kind of immediately want to rewatch it when Owen gets home because I want to share it with him. This episode is incredibly tense in this very sort of specific way that feels kind of almost claustrophobic, if that makes sense. So I'm going to be playing this in the background so that I remember everything to talk about. And I tend to do that with most of them. So forgive me if there's moments where I seem to be kind of like spacing out a little bit. But there's a lot happening and a lot of different characters and also a lot of different character names to keep track of. And it can be tricky for me when I don't have a partner who is spoiled to correct me on that stuff. So we start off like first I would like to register how much I appreciate this show emphasizing how fucking filthy everything is. Like they don't pull any punches. They don't try and make everything picturesque. Everybody is wearing tatty busted clothes. There's mud an inch and a half thick on the street, and street I say with, you know, with some reservations. And they are not shy about letting, like, reminding us just how racist everybody was as well, which I also kind of appreciate. Not a big fan of, like, hearing slurs on television all the time, but I also don't want people to fucking whitewash stuff and lie about, oh, you know, well, they got along pretty well, or, you know, because you like this guy, we're going to present him as being less racist because we want you to like him. That may be the case with certain characters at some point, but at the moment, they're fine with just having people, you know, calling the Sioux savages. At one point, the hotel owner, Farnham, is bringing a bunch of washing to Mr. Wu and calls him a leering heathen. By washing, I mean, obviously mean a body, but he, you know, disguises it as washing. And yeah, the whole thing is just really honest in a way that's like a kind of repulsive, but also I really do appreciate it. It takes some guts to be honest. So that's the opening scene is him delivering this body. We go then to, Al, who is still in bed with the woman Trixie, the whore, who brought him the gun. I wasn't sure what his reaction was going to be, like I said at the end of last episode. And it turns out that his reaction is just to tell her to get out. She's sort of like trying to be like flirtatious with him, and he's not having it at all. And I'm not sure what she thought his reaction was going to be, but at the very least, it seems like she's getting away with something that I don't feel like the others would, so she must be some kind of favorite to him. Especially because later one of the guys tries to call dibs on her, and he tells that guy to pick someone else. I think that's him doing her a favor. I could be wrong, but it's hard to know sometimes what intention is behind certain things, because things that I do not, with my modern sensibilities, interpret as an insult, then once I'm educated on like the custom, then I realize that was entirely intended to be an insult and that I'm just a little bit clueless. So, all right, let's talk about Seth, because Seth is... he doesn't like Al Swearengen. Obviously. I can't exactly blame him. But it is... he does not know how to keep his emotions in check. He's really bad at masking his feelings and keeping any kind of poker face. And I just really, like, part of me respects his being so straightforward and honest about the fact that he doesn't like this guy. And another part of me is like, you're being really stupid in the way that you're handling this dude. And you need to play the game a little bit. You can't just like wear your heart on your sleeve, you know? So I have not as of yet quite decided how I feel about this guy. I mean, he's obviously got good intentions, but so do a lot of people. So first, before we get to him going and talking to Al Swearengen, we have him going over to check on the little girl who was found at the, what everybody keeps calling them, squareheads. Anybody in the audience, if you are able to educate me on this, I don't know what that is. Is that a slur? Is like, because that feels like they say something at one point about, well, for all I know, they were speaking, they only spoke squarehead. Is that something? What is that? Like, I'm not familiar and I'm afraid to look things up because I you know, you get weird spoilers all the time when you look up something. So I just don't want to risk that. So if anybody can educate me on that. I've never heard that one before in my life. I don't think that's supposed to be their last name. Is it? Right? They're not calling them like by their name. But yeah, he goes to check on her. And it turns out that the doctor is playing it really close to the vest. Because like I said before, he has thought shit through. In a way that never even occurred to me. So he has realized that this little girl is the last living witness to what could be some major corruption in the what do they call them? Road patrols? They basically are meant to protect travelers and are probably killing them and stealing from them. And that's going to look really bad, not only for Al in general, because Al, I guess, is kind of in control of those guys. Apparently Al owns everything around here. But also, as Al points out later, it is very helpful to him if people are afraid of the Sioux in general. So if he can constantly use the Sioux as a scapegoat for all kinds of atrocities, it keeps people afraid, which keeps them having faith in his patrols. And it also keeps them from venturing out too much, especially at night. So they are more interested in going to his bar. And it just, you know, anybody who's in power, keeping the people who are not in power pitted against each other all the time, that is to their advantage. And he is totally capitalizing on that. This is a tale as old as time. Finding a minority and painting them as desperate and dangerous and bloodthirsty is just, I mean, still fucking happening. It's not new. So yeah, I said last episode, like, I wasn't sure how I felt about Al. I've decided I do not like Al. Because, you know, I, as many of you who have listened to all of my other shows know, I can forgive a lot of evil in a character. And I don't mean forgive like I think they're a good person. But I mean, I can still sort of root for somebody who has done bad shit if I feel like they're also really, really smart. Al is smart. I'll give him that. But he's also so petty and so sort of, there's just something very small about him that I do not admire at all. So in that respect, I just can't like him. He's just, he doesn't have any sort of like code that I can see except for watch out for myself. That's as far as his code goes. So this doctor has already figured out before the show has that the dudes that hurt her and her family were probably working for Al, and that she's the last living witness, and that if he tells the truth on her condition and that she's probably going to be okay, it is going to get back to Al and he is going to find a way to hurt her. So even though Seth is actually trustworthy, he's playing it really close to the vest because he knows that Seth will talk to people, because there's no way to tell Seth the truth and then also confide his suspicions without causing a lot of other problems. So it's best to just not tell him the truth. And Jane, who is just, I really enjoy Jane as a character. She is really complex and just a mess, but I really like her. She doesn't understand the doctor's motivations at first. And when he finally explains after Seth walks away, she says like that he's got a really suspicious bent of mind. But like, you know, it turns out that he is 100% correct. And damn, what a fucking turn of events, as Seth calls it later. Meanwhile, we have this like this reverend who I just think is sort of precious in his weird way. And I'm very worried that this man is going to wind up dead sooner rather than later because he's just too pure. And he is really pleased that even though Seth is the one that killed this guy, he also like commissions the reverend to build a coffin for him and to have a Christian burial for him, like an actual funeral. So there's a dude who is asking him, the reverend, like, do you know who this person is? And he found a letter that determines that the guy's name is Ned Mason. Perhaps the Tom Mason, you know, is the dead man's brother. If he's in camp, he should be notified. And this dude, I think his name is Johnny. He's just like, well, no, I sure haven't seen him around, and just doesn't like, you know, doesn't give away that it's like he knows what this means. He's already kind of cottoning on exactly what probably happened here. So, all right, let's first I want to talk about Wild Bill Hickok real quick. So Ryan Reisman, in the last episode, he was in the chat and he informed me that Wild Bill was a real person. And I went and checked out what he actually looked like, because there's a lot of photos. And he did have hair like this. His hair was way better, to be fair. They're doing what they can with this guy. But I was really startled to see like how imposing he looked in his way. I don't really think he was attractive, but he is somebody that you 100% remember if you saw him. Like, so it's not, I feel like that's part of the fame in this era, is making sure that you have a particular look that people know. And if they see you in a photo, they will put it together later. So yeah, I just wanted to register that when I went and found his picture, cause there's a lot of pictures of him, that the hair is the same. And he's getting irritated with Charlie Utter, who is his handler, is like the best way that I can think to say that. Telling people like what he's going to be doing, and the fact that he is handling him, he doesn't like it. Seth comes in after having gone to the doctor and tells him about what's going on with Jane, and that she's over at the doctor looking over that child. that the doctor is not optimistic on how she's doing. And he says something about how, like, the looks of that doctor, do you think he's been wrong once or twice in his life? Which I'm like, I'm not exactly sure what that means, because the doctor doesn't look like any more of a mess than anybody else here. But, you know, that's fine. And it's sort of just building on the fact that, which we really get hammered home later, that Wild Bill and Seth see eye to eye on a lot of things, that they are friendly and unofficial allies at this point. And it's leading Al down some weird paths, because Al seems to think that there is something official going on between Seth and Wild Bill, and that if he sells the lot, that Seth and Saul are currently renting, if he sells it to them, that he's going to be inadvertently getting into business with Wild Bill as well. I'm not entirely sure what he thinks is going to happen there. If it's just the fact that, like, Bill is as much of a badass and has as much of a reputation as he does, and he doesn't want anybody muscling in on stuff. Like, does he think that Bill is going to make a play to take over the gem? Like, Bill, that doesn't seem like his... Bill is not a man that wants to be settled somewhere, right? I don't feel like he's interested in creating a business that is going to anchor him to one place. So I'm not totally sure exactly what it is that Al is afraid of, except maybe just having somebody as dangerous as Bill as a kind of permanent resident in the town and causing a lot of trouble that way. But at the moment, Bill is an asset in that he comes and, like, you know, gambles and drinks at the gym, and they're paying him to do that. So at the moment, it seems like having Bill Hickok as a customer is an asset. So I'm not 100% on exactly what Al's problem is here, unless it's simply the principle of the thing, that he doesn't like being lied to. And that's all it is just that he feels like this guy's trying to play him somehow, and he doesn't know what could potentially happen, but he doesn't like it, which it might be that simple. But yeah, so Al is just really suspicious, and it turns out that, like, the lot that somebody just paid $600 for theirs, they're thinking to go up to $750, not past $1,000 in their offer, but Al doesn't trust them, and he wants to do, like, a deal, basically, where they pay something up front, and then he gets, like, half of their income from the sales they make over the next 3 months, and then they decide if they want to be in business together, which I feel like that's a pretty, you know, but he sort of got them by the balls. Like, what are they going to do? And Seth is not playing ball with him at all, pun intended. Just does not like the fact that this guy is insinuating, because the first time that they talk, he's turning to get the bottle for Seth and is like, I'm just grabbing it really slowly. And then he turns around and is like, well, I hear you're not a man that you want to make nervous. And Seth is deeply offended at the insinuation that he is a, what's the word I want? That he is a loose cannon. How about that? He wants his reputation to be somebody that is not to be crossed, but is fair. And that's my sort of assumption, at least. But what's actually being, what he's being told is his reputation here, is that he is somebody who will go off at any moment, that can't be trusted, that you don't want to be around because you don't know how he's going to react to things. And it's understandable that he takes exception to that. Like, that's not a vibe I think most of us want, because it insinuates not only that you are reacting to things with violence, and so you probably are less intelligent because of that, but also because it's sort of like you're saying somebody might be mentally unstable. And Seth is really offended. And it's clear that's wholly what Al intended. He wanted to kind of offend him. And I just, again, I'm not really sure what his game is here, what he's trying to do. Is he trying to see if he makes Seth mad, will he draw on him? Is that what he's sort of, like, is he trying to feel him out on whether or not he's that kind of person? Or is he trying to get Seth to draw on him because he wants everybody else to see that Seth is unstable? There could be a couple things going on here, you know? It's obvious Al is really smart. And it's obvious that he's a manipulator. But I just can't, like, he's so careful about things in some ways that I don't even know what his objective is. We have Merrick is the name of this character, played by a man that I will never not think of as the King of Austria in Amadeus. And he comes in and wants to sort of chat Seth up about everything that happened the night before. And Seth doesn't want to talk about it because he isn't reveling in this the way that some men would be. Like, there's no, I'm a hero. There's no, oh, I dealt out justice. There's no feeling of, like, victory in this. He feels really, I don't want to say guilty, but he treats it with gravity. And as they're talking, downstairs comes the wife of that city prospector, Mrs. Garrett. Now, it's not explicitly said, but Mrs. Garrett is a morphine addict. Am I right on this? Or it might be opium? Is morphine made from opium, actually? I'm not even sure about that. But she is saying, as soon as she comes downstairs, that she doesn't feel well, that she wants to see the doctor. And when the doctor comes, she is, like, really, what's the word I want? I'm not even going to say what she is. I'm going to say that he is not here to play. He knows that she's an addict. He knows that she is lying about having illness symptoms. And he isn't interested in wasting his time pretending to examine somebody who is faking, or at least their symptoms are simply from withdrawal. That he's willing to supply her with the drug that she wants in exchange for her not wasting his fucking time, which I really do respect. She tries to be like, oh, I don't know what you're talking about. And he just is not going to have it. I believe you do. I believe we understand each other. And I was just like, God damn. Doc is kind of the MVP, I'm going to say. Also, he's played by the guy who plays Grima Wormtongue, which I couldn't fucking place his face. And I had to, like, stop and, like, picture the last time that I saw his expression. And then I suddenly realized, oh my God, Grima Wormtongue, when he's talking to the King of Rohan. But he is really upfront most of the time. And the only times when he's not upfront is when it's because he's protecting someone else, which is very admirable. And she, like, so he's pretty much like, you be an addict then. I don't care. Here's the stuff. That's your problem. But I have actual people asking for my help that are waiting because I'm here with your ass for nothing. And I'm curious to see what happens with her addiction and how she pays for the drugs as well. I mean, when she goes down for coffee in the morning, her hand is really shaking when she reaches for the coffee pot. And you see, like, Bill Hickok look at her and really take note of that. So I don't know what that means, but I feel like that's going to be something that he can, like, use against the prospector at some point. And I'm not really entirely sure why he would want to do that. But I feel like the show is setting up that he notices. Meanwhile, her husband, Brom, he is out there at the river sifting and checking for gold, and he is not having good luck. There is a dude, the guy next door, on the claim next door, whose name is Ellsworth. He comes over to, like, check on them, and he's like, well, you know, it's tough, but even if you don't get any, like, actual gold nuggets, you'll almost always at least get gold flakes. And he walks away, and he seems very confident in this, and Brom turns to the man helping him, who is Doherty, who is part of this whole, like, con, and is basically like, I'm not even getting any flake. And Doherty has to sort of, oh, what's the word I want? Doherty has to play along, I guess, with like, oh yeah, I mean, that's tough, man. I don't know what to tell you. But he has to know that this claim isn't worth anything, which I'm wondering how the guy right upriver from them can get flake and he doesn't get any. You know, I mean, I just don't know how that works, how like the silt and whatnot can travel down. Does the gold also travel down river? If the guy upriver from you is having really good luck, does that mean that he's getting all of the gold that would have otherwise gotten, like, made its way down to you at some point? I don't know how this is. This exact spot showed a fistful of nuggets not two nights ago. Which I'm wondering who exactly showed him that fistful of nuggets two nights ago. Like, was that Doherty, and had those been planted? Because I feel like that's something that could easily happen. But yeah, I'm wondering if there isn't going to be some sort of retribution for Ellsworth for sort of tipping off that there isn't going to be that his claim is not turning up what should be expected. I just hope not, because I feel like everybody who gets involved with any of this at all just winds up having such bad luck, man. You know, like, Jesus Christ, everybody's going to wind up dead like, the moment anyone puts a foot wrong, Al is all over them, you know? So then we go to, okay, yeah, Johnny is his name. Johnny, who had been talking to the Reverend, comes and tells Al everything that he heard. And he immediately tells Johnny to go and get the doctor, because he's going to sort of press him on how the little girl is doing. And the doc knows precisely what the fuck is going on. It leads to, actually, a really great, very tense scene where he's, you know, helping out with all of the whores and giving them, like, salves. And a few of them use needles, probably for, you know, some kind of addiction. And he's, like, trying to get them to be sanitary about it so that they will actually not, like, wind up with infections and stuff. And that is when Swearingen comes in and just tries to casually be like, well, you know, how's that little girl doing? And the doctor is not fucking here to play. He's just not. Like, that's his entire character, is I am not here to play. Say what you want to say, and I will say to you what I want to say, and we will just get this shit done and not have to play around like this. Which I really love. He's just so much, like, he's really crotchety. He bites people's heads off when they don't necessarily mean, but he's right so often that him being as crotchety as he is feels totally excusable. He's someone who just tends to see the worst in, and I don't even mean the worst in people, in that he thinks that most people are bad people. I think that he just immediately thinks on how could somebody take advantage of this situation, and assumes that somebody out there is going to do that. Like, if he can think of it, then they must be able to think of it also, right? And I just think that's probably a really smart way to go through life. It's probably pretty tricky and difficult in terms of ever being able to trust anyone, but, you know, you have to then weigh whether or not you want to be the kind of person that can trust and how valuable that is to you versus being the kind of person who stays alive. And I feel like that works better in the end. And then Al has his meeting with the road. What are they called? I'm trying to remember the name of the, I keep wanting to say like Road Warriors. But yeah, so he goes and has this meeting and tries to talk to, is it Tom? It's not Tom, right? Tom is his brother. Ned is the one who died. So he winds up talking to, I'm finding it here. Joe, Persimmon Phil. That is a fucking name there. I didn't even realize that Tom Mason is Nick Offerman. I just found this out as I'm talking to you all because of Amazon X-Ray. What? That was Nick Offerman? I didn't even fucking, like, not even a drop of recognition. I didn't even have a, like, huh, he looks familiar. Not even a second. Wow, damn. That's, I'm really, like, reprimanding myself here. But yeah, so Al brings up Phil and is like, so, why don't you tell me what happened? And Phil's just basically, at first, playing dumb until he just straight up tells Phil, I fucking know you killed that family. So if you keep lying to me, I will literally kill you where you sit in that chair right now. I don't care. I don't. You need to be honest. And then tells him that one of the people they attacked was still alive. To which poor dumb Phil reacts by saying, no. And he's like, fucking yes. And then later, when he tells Phil, oh, and your stupid ass brother came here afterwards, again, Phil says no. Or not, it's not Phil's brother, but his stupid ass brother came back here, and Phil again says no. And he says again, keep saying no to me and I will murder you right in that fucking chair. He loves to say, I will murder you. I like that he's not saying kill. He's like using the term of the crime, which I find so much funnier for some reason. And yeah, he is essentially up his ass about the fact that they all fucked up so royally and ruined prospects of his, in terms of, like, you know, coming up, we're going to be having all of these new problems because your brother came back here. Now we got this shootout that just happened. Now we've got these guys that are, like, going to be suspicious. We have this little girl who's fucking still alive who could point at all of you. Everybody's going to find out that it wasn't Indians. It was fucking white men and ruin everything. I have my whole operation running tight and you guys have to come in here and throw a whole fucking mess into the works. And this dude is really apologetic. But of course that's not enough. Al winds up, like, tackling him to the floor. And just as he tackles him to the floor, here comes fucking Nick Offerman, stark ass naked. Guys, can I tell you how much more attention I would have paid if I had realized that it was Nick Offerman who is standing there stark ass naked? I can't even believe it. I'm watching him right now. It still doesn't look like him to me. Like, is that, are you kidding me? But yeah, stark ass naked. And he says something like, this snatch is bending, which I don't know what that means. Does that mean, like, is he talking literally? Like it's bending his dick? I don't really even know what that meant. But yeah, he's like, because he comes to the door almost like he's complaining. But then he walks away and is like, well, I'm not done yet, and walks right back into the room. So I don't know what I don't know. Or is bending, does that mean something else? Is he talking about, like, because he says this snatch is bending, but is he talking about the woman is doing something and he's just calling her snatch? Because I could see that, obviously, that they talk about all these women as if they're nothing but pussy. So I'm real confused about what he even meant by that. But as it turns out, he finds out that his brother was killed by Wild Bill, and he decides that he is going to kill this man in retribution. And it's sort of adorable because he really thinks that he's got a chance. But yo, nah, man, this is not. He's too drunk. That's really what it comes down to. I think Al really wants him to succeed, wants him to take him out. But Al has to know the likelihood of him succeeding on this is just not really going to work out. It's just, you know, may as well gamble on it. And if the guy dies, that's no skin off my back. Because then it turns out that you've only got one loose end. And as we know, when there's only the one, it's just a lot easier to deal with that. So, all right, so let's go to the scene, because after talking to the doc and talking to Phil, this is when Swearingen heads right over to the doc's place in order to see the little girl. This scene, man, this was really good. He goes in there and he makes up some bullshit lie about how the doc wanted me to come and see your patient. And Jane gets up and says, "Who the fuck are you?" And she had said when the doc left before, "If anybody tries to come in here, they're going to be fucking sorry." And as soon as Swearingen comes in and she says, "Who the fuck are you?" he just stops and stares at her. And she backs right up. She literally takes a step back. Because Jane ain't no fool. Poor Jane. And she can see in this man's eyes that he is not a person to be fucked with. Like, I think she can just tell. Here's a man who murders all the goddamn time and could not care less and sleeps perfectly well. And he says something about how if he took a knife to her, she'd die really slow. And she starts to try and like, repeat herself, "Don't touch her, don't touch her, get away from her, you. And then she begins to sort of stutter. And it's really awful to watch, like, her acting in this scene of her yelling at him, but being, like, stock still otherwise and not taking a step toward him. And as he pinches the little girl and she opens her eyes and makes it very clear that she is conscious, she... it's just so, like, she goes to, what's the word? She starts to escalate from just telling him to leave her alone to then, like, calling him a cocksucker. Like, the most that she can do is increase the kinds of swears and the insults that she's throwing at him, but she still can't physically seem to move. And she says to him, as he's leaving, "Do it to me if you have to." And he says, "Why would I do it to you?" as he walks out. Which is like the whole, like, did she mean kill me instead? Because, yeah, what good does that do? I guess she doesn't really know exactly what his motivations are here yet. But it's really a painful scene because Jane puts up a really good front that she is... you know, she acts like she's a violent badass, and she may be. But as of right now in the show, we have not seen her do harm to anyone. We have seen her go off half-cocked and yelling at people and acting like she's going to do something. But in terms of her actual, like, follow-through, there's been really nothing. So I'm wondering just how much of her is just talk. And how much of her is not talk, but that he scared her enough that it kept her from taking action. Because, you know, if she is somebody who would normally throw a punch or pull a gun, and he kept her from doing that simply because of being as intimidating as he is, that's a whole other kettle of fish than her being somebody who talks a big game and doesn't ever follow it up. And I just don't know her quite well enough yet to be able to tell which one we're dealing with here. I tend to think it's the first one that she normally does throw a punch, but she doesn't hear because he's so intimidating. Because she says later to what's-his-face that he scared me. I haven't been scared like that since I was a little girl. So I tend to think it's the first one. But again, that's just a guess based on that. And the doc sees him coming out, sees Al coming out and asks, did you hurt her? And he says, no, but she's better than he thought. Her eyes are open. And just essentially lets him know that the game is on now. And the doc decides that he is going to, what's the word I want? He's going to, what is it when knights have to stay awake all night? He's going to have a vigil, I guess. Is that the word I want? But he's basically just going to sit next to this girl's bed awake all night with a shotgun in his lap. And it turns out to be a pretty fucking good thing that he does. Because as much as Doherty does not want to kill this little girl, he clearly would have done it. Because what his conscience wants and what he's willing to do are not the same two things. So, and when he gets back and Jane is so ashamed of herself and still so afraid, it's really sad to see her trying to like justify herself to him, but also being really ashamed. And just she's trying to defend herself while also clearly feeling like she doesn't have any defense. Road agent. Thank God she said it. I could not remember the term that they used. Road agent was, and he tells her he owns the gem saloon. Then what is it to him if she can open her eyes? And he doesn't tell her. She says, does the road agents work for him? And he still won't really like answer her. He just tells her, gone, and I will take care of her. Which clearly she feels like she's being dismissed for like failing him. But he tells her that she has a gift for this kind of thing. I can't tell if he's fucking with her or not. I think he's like, well, he's clearly not fucking with her in like trying to mess with her head. What I mean by fucking with her is I can't tell if he's just trying to placate her in the moment or if he is being sincere, like really sincere about the fact that she would probably make a good doctor. But it's a hard scene because there is like that doubt in her mind as well on whether or not he's just telling her what she wants to hear. And I feel bad for Jane because it feels like she doesn't really have a place and doesn't know what to do with herself. So yeah, the whole thing is just really awkward and sad and emotional. So we have the moment where Mr. Garrett returns to the inn. And if y'all remember last episode, Mr. E.B. Farnham offered to buy this, claim that he now owns for 16,000, I think, but it was part of the con. He was doing this in order to drive up the overall price. Well, Mr. Garrett here is realizing that maybe his claim does not have that much gold on it. Also, it's really hard backbreaking work, and maybe he just wants to sell and get out of this fucking mess that he's made. But of course, when Mr. Farnham is presented with this offer to follow through on the purchase that he was going to make, it seemed, the previous night, he's like, oh no, I was just really drunk. And Mr. Garrett's like, you sure did not seem drunk. And it's really like a sad moment in a way, although I don't like Mr. Garrett, so I don't exactly feel bad for him. But just him realizing that he's been played because he spent all his money and is going to have to take out some credit to, you know. So either he sticks it out and tries and gets some gold off of this claim, or he finds some other dope to sell to. But the look on his face when he realizes, like, he looks like he's going to start shaking. he's so upset. And I feel for him because there's nothing quite like the moment that you realize that you got taken for a fucking ride. And I think a lot of us have gone through that in one way or another. I had it happen when I paid somebody to build a website for me and they never finished. And I, you know, I went and paid ahead like a fucking dumbass, and I should not have done that. But yeah, it was a, you know, really sick to your stomach sort of, I can't believe I was that stupid feeling. And by extension, now knowing that Mr. Farnham was probably in on it, he is able to put it together that likely Al was in on it as well. And apparently he had told his wife that Mr. What is Al's last name? Senegin? But anyway, he had told his wife that Al was like their one of their only friends here. And he's realizing that that's probably not the case at all. So then he comes up with this fucking plan that he thinks he's going to like hire Bill Hickok to kill Al. This precious little cinnamon roll. And I mean that in the most condescending way possible. You come to Wild Bill and try and act like he's a fucking gun for hire, and that is going to be some insulting shit. He is. You'd be lucky to get out of that alive, or at the very least, lucky to get out without having your ass beat all to hell. Because I feel like you make that kind of offer, and that's just, that's so deeply insulting. And it's such a city man thing to do, to not really understand that somebody who is willing to kill because of their own principles that they hold, whatever those may be, whether you agree with them or not, is a very different sort of person than somebody who agrees to kill for money. And I just don't think that's going to go well for him at all. So let me go to Swearingen. And that is his last name. Telling Doherty that he has to kill this little girl. And poor Doherty, I really appreciate that he's basically crying the entire time that he's walking over there. Just the thought of having to do this is weighing on him so hard, as it fucking should. And it makes me think better of him. Fucking Swearingen himself could give a shit. And I really wonder whether or not it would be as easy for him if he were the one to pull the trigger. But I feel like it would be as easy for him because he's that cold-hearted. I don't think that he's somebody who's like, you know, having somebody do his dirty work because he's too, like, soft-stomached to do it himself. I don't think that's what it is. I think he just literally cannot be seen, but if he could do it himself, he would. And that's rough. And I feel like Doherty knows that as well, that he would do it. And that's also part of the problem, is that, like, I can't not fulfill at least what he would be willing to do. So he's heading over there at the same time that downstairs guys are getting drunk, and there's some shit going on with Wild Bill and Seth, because Wild Bill can tell that there is a man waiting at the end of the bar to do him harm. And he asks Seth to have his back. He knows. I'm not sure exactly how he knows, but he does. He's got a real sixth sense for this. And Seth can tell when he points out the guy. He's like, do you see him? And he's like, yes, sir, I do. So that's all beginning to brew as Doherty heads over to the docks. Meanwhile, we have Swearingen. He comes downstairs and he wants to talk to Seth. And Seth decides to make Saul his proxy for this deal because he can't talk to this man in, like, with a civil tone to his voice So he'd rather just not deal with him, which I just find hilarious. And when Saul goes over to him and tells him the deal that Swearengen wants to make with the two of them, where he like takes half their earnings for like 3 months, he gets so angry that he finally does decide to come over and talk to Al, who tells him, like, you came over here and rent a lot from me. Within 6 hours, you blow in a guy's eye with Wild Bill Hickok backing your play. Next day, I'm supposed to sell you the lot, put you in business without asking who the fuck you are or what the fuck you're doing here. And Seth tries to say Bill Hickok being involved, as he puts it, was a turn of events. He tries to, and apparently what Saul called it earlier was a coincidence. But Al doesn't buy it. And I just, this scene is so great. I'm making you a sensible proposal. You answer by insulting me in my own joint. And he then tries to say to him, he corrects Seth's grammar at one point, which I love so much. I know it's so stupid, but I just love it so much. What is it that Seth says? I'm trying to find the exact moment. Here's my offer to your counteroffer. Go fuck yourself, is how this ends up. But I could have sworn that there was another moment where Seth says, don't tell me what the fuck I meant. I missed it, but it winds up being diffused by Trixie coming up to him and saying the best bath and blowjob you ever had is not 12 steps away up those stairs, which he does not wind up going for, but it sort of reminds him that he's in a public place, I think, is the main thing. So that scene, honestly, the two of them going like button heads is really fun to watch. I just really, they're two very strong actors, really dedicated to their characters, and it's just really fun to watch. So Saul and Seth go outside for him to cool off. Seth tells Saul, all right, fine, we'll take his fucking stupid ass offer, but as soon as we get the chance, we're buying it out from under him. And they are passing by Charlie Utter. And he's pissing against somebody's tent. And I'm just like, oh, lovely. And he's talking about how Wild Bill is not easy to manage, but he needs somebody to manage him, because he is simply not up to dealing with the minutiae from day to day that the average man needs to be able to do to take care of himself. He says to Seth, you've got a lot of his qualities, but you got something he's missing. You get along with people, turn a dollar, look out for yourself. He don't know how to do that. Which sort of makes it feel like he's trying to say, I want y'all to become buddies with us. But he's not exactly saying. He says, so I'd like to know your secret so as I can tell it to Bill. And Seth says, I don't know any secrets. Don't tell me. Find occasion to tell him yourself. He likes you. Just don't wait too long. Which I'm like, what exactly does that mean? But I feel like Bill actually, or I keep wanting to call him Bill. I feel like Charlie actually does care about Bill. And is frustrated by the fact that he's like such an imposing figure in so many ways, and yet so unable to like live without help, you know? Meanwhile, we have Tom getting really, really drunk at one end of the bar while his friend watches him and is just like, oh, dude, you are so gonna die. This is terrible. I hate being party to this. And this is when Bill comes up and tells Seth to have my back. So Bill goes and sits down to play a game. Tom is still fucking drinking at the other end of the bar. Like, he keeps on being like, all right, I'm going now. And then being like, nope, 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 I need one more shot. And Seth tells Saul to step away from him. Step away from himself, not step away from Bill Hickok. So Saul is aware that some shit is about to go down also. So finally, we have Tom, because he's like gripping his hands. He puts his hat on. He's got his knife. Like, he's obviously going to stab this dude or shoot him or God knows. But I think he was going to stab him. So he starts walking up. No words and no gun till you're on him, is what his friend tells him, Phil. But he's like obviously not hearing anything. Like, he's just such a disaster, man. He could barely walk straight. And you can see Bill's sort of like peripheral vision. Like, he doesn't look at him, but he raises his head in such a way that you can tell he's aware this guy just got up. And he's doing this also to sort of signal to Seth. And it doesn't look like he's paying attention. But when the dude gets close enough, and he hasn't even pulled on him, Wild Bill pulls on him first and shoots him in the gut. And they try and say that man's gun never left his holster. And he just says, that man meant me harm. And Seth backs him up and says he went for his gun. I saw it. Which I don't think you did, Seth. But apparently you're willing to throw down on this man's behalf. So, all right, we know that. Apparently we've got that. It's a pretty intense scene that I really like, because it just shows you like how Wild Bill works, and the fact that he's like basically willing to ask forgiveness. He's not willing to ask permission. So this guy doesn't have to draw on him. I'm going to take care of my fucking self. And y'all can figure out all the details regarding the law later on, because I don't care. And that shot like rings out while Jane and Charlie are outside talking. I really like the part where she confides in him that Al really scared her, because she doesn't like Charlie for whatever reason, but she's so drunk here that she's willing to just like be honest for a second. And this is when she sees Doherty walking by, and Doherty is like a friggin' zombie in a way, trying to ignore the fact that he's crying. And Jane sees him and is just like, what the fuck is your problem? Not really realizing what he's doing or who he's associated with. And he gets to the doc's door. Doc pulls up the shotgun. And they talk, and it's very clear to the doc that Doherty does not want to be doing this. Do what you're going to do, because I'm not moving. And Doherty says, Jesus Christ, you're pitting me against Al. And so the fuck be it, replies the doctor, which is a great line. And they decide to both risk his ire by staging. And it's, again, the kind of thing where I don't know how much they expect Al to believe them versus Al to simply deal with the situation as it now stands, whether he believes them or not. I don't know how convincing they think they were with the story, or whether they're just betting on him doing whatever is most practical, regardless. But what they decide to do is give Jane and Charlie, the little girl, have them run off with her, and then go to the two of them, Doherty and the doc, go back and tell Al that, oh, these two that work for Bill Hickok just made off with the girl. They knew some shit was going down. So mysterious. I don't know how they knew, but they saved her. And so I guess we'll have to track her down or something, but who knows where they went. And what Al winds up doing is just taking the very last of the road agents up to his office and killing him up there because he's really the last, like, and he's more of a liability. Like, the little girl is likely not going to ruin everything for him if the, all the guys are dead. But if this one guy stays alive, he has bad judgment and has already fucked shit up once. So maybe don't let him do it again, I think is the mental process of Al in that moment. Better to get rid of somebody who doesn't fucking follow the basic rules that I have set up. And also, he's hearing that Hickok killed a man and that Seth backed him up again. So he's realizing that it seems like they are friends, no matter what Seth said. And he's not exactly wrong at this point. I think they are friends. I think that's unofficially what's going on. But he thinks that they're sort of trying to, what's the word? I think that he's trying to find out if they're trying to con him, which is not what's going on. But at this point, whether or not that was what they planned to do, whether or not they were going to go in business together from the start on purpose, they may wind up partnered up in a weird way. So it turns out that maybe some of his fears were justified a little bit. And Al is trying to figure out what happened with Tom, who was about to try and kill Hickok, whether or not Tom really like broadcast what he was about to do, whether or not he did go for his gun. And Phil is staunchly like, no, he must have just smelled him. But he didn't say anything or do anything, in my opinion, that let him know. I think that's true to a layman. I don't think that I would have necessarily seen Tom and known, but these are supposed to be guys with a better sense of that stuff than me. So I can't decide if Phil is being generous in his explanation to Al or if he's just telling him the truth. So yeah, this ends with him strangling this guy. It's a really sudden, he like shakes his hand and is looking into the, what do you call it? Safe, and gets this guy to lean down and pulls out a knife and like stabs him. And I had thought for a second that he had also strangled him, but I guess he didn't. It's a very sudden, like weirdly staged murder. But he goes out to the balcony and says, bring the sled, which lets them know that there's a body up there to take care of. And the doc and Doherty look at each other knowingly because they realize that if he's killed that guy, then the little girl is ultimately safe. I don't know what the fuck Jane and Charlie Utter are going to do, though, because I feel like they can't come back to town, can they? Like, but they have to because they work for Bill. So I don't know what that's going to, but I do love, can I just say, I love so much how angry Jane gets that Charlie Utter is not doing row, row, row your boat with her. I can't, it's so funny to me. Oh my God. She stops and yells at him. God damn it. Meanwhile, this poor girl is like barely, she's awake. Her eyes are open here. But she's almost catatonic. Like, she's not talking. She's not moving around. So, I don't know. Are they just going to come, like, swinging back into town? Are they going to find somebody's, some family to, like, take care of her? I'm very curious. But this show is so good, guys. And I'm really, you know, Bill Hickok and Seth versus Al is a fight that I definitely want to see. So I'm looking forward to finding out how that plays. So again, next episode is going to be a week from today. Again, same time, 11 a.m. on the 5th, Tuesday. And there, the next like two episodes after that are booked at the same time. So yeah, guys, if you want to hang out and find out how I'm reacting to the rest of this. There's only two seasons. I don't know how many episodes there are per season. So I don't know how exactly, like, how long it will take to finish covering all of them. But yeah, I am almost definitely going to go and watch the next episode, like, right as soon as I'm done recording this. So thank you again, Patrick, for commissioning these. This has been a lot of fun to cover. Really appreciate everybody showing up as well. And I will be seeing you all soon with a new episode. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Spoiled Network Podcast.